The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Father, this day, I believe that you are going to release a special anointing to accomplish the purposes for which you've sent us here and which you've gathered us together. And I pray that each and every person leaves with an ability for the transfiguration on the inside of something good. Some portion of you be delivered to them in such a way that they're ignited and there's more of you in their life. And return us back to the simplicity that's in Jesus, that we would walk in his lordship in the days ahead. Amen. Amen. Today's message is entitled Dominion Authority. Dominion Authority. Actually, the Greek word is kratos. That's my favorite for authority. When the king comes in, he takes over and occupies the territory. And that's really what we're teaching. The lordship of Jesus is that when he comes into an area of life, he comes over and he's Lord. There's a big difference between, and I think where we can get lazy as Christians is, oh, I'm born again. I have Jesus as my Savior. I want him as Lord, moment by moment, all day long. Savior is nice. Lord is better. And to make him Lord, we need the practical how-tos in that application. So when the king comes in, he takes over and he occupies the territory. In Daniel chapter 2, if you want to open your Bibles to that, Daniel chapter 2, particularly verses 34 and 35, as well as verse 44, it says, "You watched while a rock was cut out without hands, which struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them into pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were crushed together and became like chaff from the summer threshing floors. The wind carried them away so that no trace of them was found. And the rock that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. And in the days of these kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom which could never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It shall break in pieces and consume all of these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever." I believe that what God is restoring is that the glory of the Lord is going to cover the earth as the waters covered the sea. In 1989, I was sitting under a tree, and God gave me the strategy for the end times, and he called it the Gideon strategy. And I find it interesting that the Gideon strategy was a remnant. It was a remnant of 300. And it was basically a strategy that would be, it's more than a strategy, but it's basically a strategy for the end times, that you shall strike the enemy as one man. And that's corporate. That's not singular. When he told Gideon, in other words, the 300 will strike the enemy as one man. And it's interesting because the strategy is been depicted scripturally, not only in the book of Judges, which went down from some 32,000 down to 300. Fearless people. Fearless people meant basically the peace of God ruled in their life, or shalom. As a matter of fact, he appeared to Gideon as Jehovah Shalom. Isn't that interesting? He's about to go to war, but he appeared as Jehovah Shalom. Because that peace, that God of peace, will crush the enemy beneath your feet, won't he? And that's the part that's often missing, is the militancy out of the peace of God. The peace of God not only guards your heart and your mind, it crushes the enemy. It's militant. And God was going to appear to Gideon as Jehovah Shalom, because Gideon was what? Afraid, hiding, trying to etch out a living. And God appeared to him as the God of peace. And that Shalom, that God of lordship, is the God of that kingdom. And what's interesting, I'm sitting without a Bible in hand, and God's basically quickening scriptures to me. I'm sitting under a tree in 1989, and he says, Judges 6:16, I believe that is. You shall strike the enemy as one man. That was the message given. And God basically said that is going to be the strategy for the end times. Understanding what that one man is, that one corporate man. And basically it said that you will strike the enemy as one man. And then he took me to Isaiah 9. Isaiah 9 is a prophecy 600 years in advance of Messiah Jesus. 600 years. It says a people who sit in darkness shall see a great light. As in the day of Midian. The day of Midian was Gideon's battle with the Midianites. So the advent of the Messiah Jesus was pronounced as the Prince of Peace, and that a people who sit in darkness shall see a great light as in the day of Midian. What do they mean, as in the day of Midian? Remember how they won the battle? How many are even familiar with Gideon's battle? What they did was they had the torches inside the pitchers, smashed the pitchers, and light shined, and the enemy fled. That's a militant victory, because when the enemy runs, we have most of the body of Christ, what, running from the enemy, right? We have to get to the place where the enemy is confused. What's the favorite tactic of the enemy? It's to confuse believers. But when the enemy is confused, you're accomplishing something. And the only thing that can confuse the enemy is the rule of God. And when the rule of God is the shalom of God, it's the peace of God, it's the kingdom of God, I'll tell you what, that's what's going to spread. That's rock Jesus is going to spread throughout all eternity, as it says, and it shall consume all of those other kingdoms, and they shall be brought down. It says in Isaiah 9, 600 years before Jesus, for unto us a child is born and a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Every time you enter into the supernatural peace of God, that is not nothing. That is an evidence of the rule of God in your life and evidence of an expansion of the kingdom. And as that peace increases in your life, you overcome everything that's in the world, the flesh, or the devil. Peace will crush the enemy beneath your feet. And peace is going to be the battle cry of one new man. One new man is Jew and Gentile together, yes. But Jesus said, I have created one new man from the two. And it's going to be in that anointing between the two coming together in Messiah Jesus that's going to be the strategy for the end times. There is an ever-increasing amount of Jewish believers becoming believers. There's actually a mandate to go forward and bring them the good news. And I believe that we're seeing and we're on the verge of that. And it's already begun, and it's going to increase just as Daniel said it would increase, that the kingdom shall not be left to other people. It'll break into pieces and consume all the kingdoms, and it'll stand forever. And the glory of the Lord is going to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. It's going to be continually expanding. Actually, the peace of God has never stopped expanding. God's kingdom has always been expanding. But I just want to teach the one thing is that the missing ingredient in our churches, if we're going to get people to grow up, is how do I do that instead of what to do? What to do is knowledge. How to do it is the wisdom of application. And we're asking God for the supernatural wisdom of God to give us strategies and give us practical application in the simplicity of making him Lord over our lives. We have what we call a peace challenge that is, quite frankly, quite challenging to highly gifted people, because you can be highly gifted and your character can be remiss. Is that possible? I know it's possible, because that was our ministry for 12 years when we traveled. We ministered to as many as 50 leaders in 3 days, 2.5 days, 3 days, through a network of ministries. And what we found was highly gifted people often have some areas in their life that are keeping them from being all that they could be. And that's what has to be brought: death, burial, and resurrection. It has to be eradicated from their hearts and lives so that they can flourish and accomplish the purposes that God had ordained for them. The weakness is in highly gifted people is they think, because I'm highly gifted and out there, I must not have need, or why am I out here as a highly gifted person? And that is the perfect setup for the enemy. And it happens again and again and again. And they crash and burn. And what God's saying is that I'm going to start dealing with their character. Because you know what? We could all say that. Lord, Lord, did I not cast out devils? Did I not prophesy? And he says, depart from me, I knew you not, because the relationship was what was missing, not the gifting. Gifting's a beautiful thing, but gifting is not a badge of accomplishment in the kingdom. So I want to give you the two steps that I saw in the simplicity of Jesus. And it's James 4:7. Submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee. I want to train up a body of believers to where the supernatural shalom of God will be their battle cry, just like it was for Gideon. And just like Jesus himself was called the Prince of Peace, know the Prince of Peace in a relational way to where he stands up on the inside and starts crushing the enemy beneath your feet. Submit to God and resist the devil, and he will flee. I believe we've got to raise up a generation that doesn't just know how to deal with their issues and die to their agendas. They're going to have to learn how to resist more effectively. Now, look, here's the scriptures. You've heard this your whole life, but now doing it's a whole other ballgame, isn't it? This is where the rubber meets the road. Can I do it? Quoting your scripture does not impress me. It's when you can live what you're quoting. All right? The peace of God guards your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Do you believe that? Then, in reality, if you are walking in the lordship of Jesus, how would you know if you're walking in the lordship? Let the peace of God rule. That translates at that moment, Jesus is Lord. He's not just your Savior, he's Lord. When you have peace, Jesus is Lord. When you lose your peace, you got off on a tangent. I don't care if it's hurt, fear, lust, anger, guilt, shame. You are on a tangent. And there are some gifted people who walk in low-grade anxiety all the time. You know what that means? That means they're more acclimated to the kingdom of fear than they are the Prince of Peace. Maybe they shouldn't be looking so much at their gifting. They should be looking at their heart. Because peace indicates the rule of God. Peace is not like the world gives. The peace that Jesus gives is a supernatural exchange that says, I am Lord. Let the peace of God rule. This is not poetry. This was meant to be living it out. We have a peace challenge here that I've saw some mature Christians get totally flabbergasted by it. They realize how very minimal their Christian walk was in peace. Let the peace of God rule. To what degree does it rule? When you go to work and there's a bunch of hostile people, do you contribute to that atmosphere, or does your peace bring calm to storm? You know, I think it was Bill Johnson, you say, if you can't sleep in the boat, you're not going to stand up in the boat and say, peace be still. If you're sitting in the boat like, oh, Jesus, oh, peace be still, you know, you people are real good at quoting it, but if it's not coming from the heart, it has no anointing. Listen to me, because the church has been overstimulated on saying the right answer. You don't say the right answer if it's coming from the wrong source. Now, wouldn't you think that was ridiculous? But you know how many prayer meetings I've been to that I could discern they were doing just that? They were praying their worries, they're praying their fears, and they're calling it intercession. It's out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. The source. Not saying the right answers. I am weary of Christians giving me the right answers while they're terrified. I already knew the right answer, and so do you. The point is not the answer. The point is the source of the answer. It's either in Jesus. You know, it's really simple. Root what something is rooted in. I don't care how complicated people are. I used to deal with all well above. I don't know why God did that. I married one. But God sent me to all highly gifted geniuses. I've dealt with two different surgeons. I've discipled Harvard graduates. I've discipled, and here I was just trying to get people off drugs. But God chose that. I didn't pick it. He's using the simple to confound the wise is what he was doing. You know, watch. I'll take Dennis who's going, the rest of the guys, you know, with his Chicago accent, and he's going to go up with these scholarly people. But in reality, what he's going to do is that teach him to walk in the Spirit has nothing to do with your intellectual capacity. To walk in the Spirit, we're all on the same level. Children can actually learn faster than a Rhodes Scholar.
That's right.
The Harvard graduate was doing 10 engineer's jobs in the factory where I worked when I was a young Christian. 10. And then he would go to the library and study art because he was bored. But you know what he said when I discipled him? He said, the education of the mind comes through much study, but the education of the heart comes only by the anointing of God. If the anointing of God doesn't teach you in your heart, you don't know anything. So God called us in this ministry, and we ordained Rebecca along with the others. This is our mission. Our mission is to take the ones who really believe they're mature and hold their feet to the fire and see if there's room to grow. Do you think there's room to grow? Okay. Worst thing you can do is be a church armchair expert where you go, I already know that. I already know that. Anyone that says, I already know that, I already know that, doesn't understand the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of God can always go deeper in the same truth. So there's never enough of Jesus. So when you say, I already know that, that's an indication of spiritual pride. No, you don't know it. Whatever level you know it, you could know it deeper. I already heard that. That tells me that your level of hearing is probably like rock. All right? Roots grow down deep into receptive, good soil that says, I'm learning and learning. Submit to God, resist the enemy. To the degree that you learn to resist the enemy, you mature. I want you to just think about that. So how do I resist? You resist in two places. In here is the will. And when peace rules, Jesus rules. If something comes at you, let's picture Jesus. Did Jesus give in to sin? No. Was he in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted of the devil? If it was a legitimate temptation, he had to feel the pressure. If he didn't feel the pressure, it's not a legitimate temptation. Say, oh, well, he was Jesus. He was God. He was tempted in all ways as we were, yet without sin. So how did he resist? He was in the wilderness. He had in him the Spirit of God in communion with his Father by the power of the Spirit, walked as a man, though he were God, and yet he learned obedience by the things that he suffered. People don't picture Jesus suffering. Suffering is not giving in. Suffering is resisting with the Word of God and the Holy Spirit and then maturing accordingly. So how do I resist? If I have the peace of God ruling, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is ruling. If I hear thoughts that are coming, that's not him. Peace guards my mind. I can't stop thoughts from coming in no more than you can stop a bird from landing on your head. All right? If it makes a nest, that's your fault. That's the old saying, right? If he makes a nest, that's your problem. But landing on your head, nothing to do about it. But if I hear a thought and I go, that's not me, I am making a distinction that will keep my thought life safe as a believer. What do I mean by that's not me? I am making a distinction that the new creation me loves God, loves his word, and if it's contrary to the word of God, I'm not taking it in. I'm a new creation. I've something that never existed before. I'm a new creation that is a fusion between my spirit and God's spirit. He created something that never existed before, and that never existed me is a new creation me, and that new creation me loves God and loves the word, and when I hear something that's talking bad about me, that's not me. Do you know what most people do? Even mature believer? Oh, I heard it in my head. It must be true. I'm no good. I'm a loser. Yeah, that makes sense. Jesus is up there on the day of creation. He's making all these people for generations yet to come. And he goes, and then I'm going to make Dennis a loser. Yeah. I need some losers to make the other people look good. Yeah, so I'll make Dennis a loser, and then all these other people will feel good that they're okay. He don't work that way, does he? He made you as one of a kind. There never was another you. There never will be another you. If you would ever let the garbage get out of the way and hear the word of the Lord, that you are a one of a kind. There never was another you. There never will be another you. You are precious and valuable. You have intrinsic value, and you had this value before you were formed in your mother's womb, before you had a chance to screw it up. Before you were formed, he carried you in his heart and loved you and gave himself for you. That's the real you. And until you start living out of that real you, you're just a copy of somebody else. So you were born an original, and you're going to go all through life dying a copy, trying to be like somebody else. What a loser. That's a loser. But God didn't make you that way. You did it all by yourself. Who was it that one guy even said? He said, God basically didn't. The devil's beating me up. He said, the devil don't have to beat you up. Most of you are beating yourselves up with your own carnality. We have found the enemy. It is you. Come on, be honest. If you're going to mature as a thing of God, you got to quit talking bad about yourself. You need to really enter into a season of repentance that talking bad about myself is poking God in the eye. If you're a believer, to talk bad about yourself is poking God in the eye, and you have to stop it. Bob Newhart charged $5 for that advice once. All right, Bob Newhart says, I can cure anybody for $5 in 5 minutes. You tell me your problem. And he says, stop it. That'll be $5. All right. Maybe we need to return back to that simplicity because we are God indwelt. Maybe we ought to stop it. And one lady kept on going on, but I'm afraid of being alone. I'm always afraid of being contained and constricted and confined and locked in a closet and everything. He said, I told you, stop it, $5. And she kept going on and on and on and on. He goes, all right. Another $5, I'll give you the solution. If you don't stop it, I'm going to put you in a box and bury you alive. So that's what pastors want to do every once in a while with Joe and Helen Weiner. It's like, oh, come on, get over it. All right. But here's the way the Lord taught me to do it. One is recognizing your new identity, that you're not finished yet, but you are a new creation. You're something precious and beautiful in His sight. You're a one of a kind. Start living from that and then resist the things that are contrary to that. You resist it in the thoughts by saying, that's not me. And you resist it in the emotion by not taking in. Letting peace guard your heart means peace will guard me from toxic emotion. So that means if I walk in an office and I've got 5 angry people in the office and they're all having thrown a fit, if I maintain my peace, I can actually, whether they want to or not, I can evangelize them by bringing God's kingdom into that realm. Maybe they'll respond to it, maybe they won't. What's the difference? What's the difference? You're supposed to do what's right. You do what's right. And if peace is maintained in the presence of 5 arguing, angry people, then the kingdom of God has made a display. If you get irritated, which is a form of anger, if you get irritated because 5 people are angry, they evangelized you. I'd say that's a character weakness. I'd say, at what point are we going to start acting like new creation people? If they can push your buttons, then you got a button, probably need to get rid of that button. Huh? Because peace really does guard your heart and your mind. How many people, they tried to start with our peace challenge before they dealt with some of their issues and agendas? And they just crumbled, and they thought they were mature saints. They thought, oh, man, I've been in church 25 years. I know everything. I know my Bible backwards, upside down, and yeah, except that it's not real. Huh? Try the peace challenge once. But if it doesn't work, then go back and let God deal with the issues. Issues and agendas need to pass through death yet live. Death, burial, and resurrection. What I saw people doing is like, well, you got to kill it. Every time I heard preachers say you got to kill it, that usually means stuff it. Very few know how to bring it to death. They just stuff it. Stuffing it is not killing it, because what you suppress will get expressed later at all the wrong times. To truly kill it is not to annihilate it or cause it to cease to exist, but that which is passes through death yet lives under the lordship of Jesus. It's resurrection. Resurrection means I'm not trying to destroy your mind, your will, or your emotions. I want them under the rule of God. I want them under the authority of God. All right? We're getting there. We're getting there. But here's the way God taught me. The simple way is resist mind and emotion. When you feel fear on people's words or in an angry group of people are arguing, and you're basically, as long as you maintain peace, you could even be part of the redemptive solution. Your yes could be yes, your no could be no. Or you could say, later, I'll talk to them later. You know, it's like, this is not the right atmosphere. But the way that God taught me to do it on a regular basis was, how many have heard the teaching on the seven mountains? Okay. God taught me many years ago, if you don't deal with the seven internal mountains, you're not going to be any good in those seven external mountains. Remember, if you can't sleep in the boat, you're not going to have the authority to stand up in the boat and say, peace be still. So God basically told me, if you want to walk in the lordship of Jesus, you've got to start in these seven thrones. If you're a note taker, you can write these down. They're very general. Spirit, your human spirit, mind, will, emotions, all relationships, friend and foe, the good, the bad, and the ugly, all relationships, all your possessions, all of your possessions include spiritual gifts, natural gifts, spiritual gifts, and lastly, your physical body, of which God has been doing a miracle work in our lives. As we've been making him Lord of our physical body, we're walking in better health than we've ever walked in. And I've even discovered something neat. This is kind of a side item, but this has been real, and I'll get into it later some other time. But how many have ever had pain in your body move from location to location? Isn't that bizarre? You know what I consider those? Those are false symptoms. And I have Jesus, the Messiah, Jehovah Nissi, the miracle worker, Jehovah Rapha, the healer on the inside of me, who rides with healing in his wings. And when I feel pain or discomfort in a particular part of my body, I welcome Jesus, my healer, to go to that part. Well, how many know what soaking is? Okay. When soaking came in, I was saying, I've been doing that for 2 decades before soaking was popular, only I soaked with specificity. In other words, I wanted not just Jesus. I wanted an attribute or a character quality that he is, I am that I am. I am whatever you need. I am that I am. I wanted that I am in a particular way. So I would welcome him. And the funny thing is, I'd welcome him into my back, and I'd feel the back pain go. And when I say welcome him, I don't stop. I'm not saying this did this in 5 minutes. I mean, I do this as a regular thing. This is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and it belongs to him. And if I feel pain in my back, I welcome Jesus, my healer, on the inside of me to go to. I don't call out to heaven. He's in heaven. But I'm God indwelt, and we've got to start thinking that way. Otherwise, we're imposing some unnecessary distance. On earth as it is in heaven is the goal and the purpose of God. So start dealing with Jesus the healer on the inside of you. And so I'd feel it in my shoulder. And sure enough, the more I got used to doing it for days at a time while I'm walking around, I'm walking to Publix grocery store, and I'm walking around trying to concentrate on what I'm getting, but I'm welcoming Jesus into my shoulder, welcoming Jesus into my knees, welcoming Jesus into my leg, just welcoming the healer to flow. And the funny thing is, it gets healed and something else acts up. And so I'm going, hey, I don't care. I could do this the rest of my life. This body's a temple. Okay, Jesus, go to that corner of the temple. Okay, go to that room in my temple. Go to that room. And get used to soaking to where you don't shut down. It's not like old-time church where you come forward for an altar. I got to get healing. I got a backache. Jesus, bless me. Lay hands on me. Do you lay hands on me? And they don't get it instantly. It doesn't happen. So they go back to their chair. Well, I guess God didn't want to. We are so impatient and so shallow, when in reality, lordship means you stay open and you never shut down. I've had healings that took 3 years, and I've had healings that were instant. I'm not in charge of that. Jesus is. But I'm in charge of my attitude and my openness, and I don't want any barriers between me and my healing. Physically, I'm talking. And it's the same with emotions. Any toxic emotion is a barrier between you and your Jesus. That's the way he spoke to me as a baby Christian. When I start feeling fear, he'd say, Dennis, don't let anything come between what you and I have together. He made it relational instead of theological. And if I felt fear, if I felt shame, if I felt hurt, it was coming between me and him and our union. And how did I know? How did I know when I'm back in union? Peace. Peace is not like the world gives. It's supernatural, and it's a valid indication of his lordship. Before we even go any further, let's do that right now. If you've got pain in your physical body, welcome Jesus the healer, not in Joe Heavy Speaker, in you, the priesthood of the believer. Welcome Jesus the healer to rise with healing in his wings and flow to that part of your body. And if you don't have anything, do what Jennifer and I do. I welcome health. Every cell in my physical body, every system says, open ye gates, let the King of glory come in. Every cell in my physical body, every system is God welcoming. I am God welcoming the spirit of Jesus the healer, Jehovah Rapha, rise with healing in your wings, every cell in my body. You know, every individual cell has gates and channels. I say, open you gates, let the King of glory in. I'm a God welcoming temple in the Holy Spirit. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, and I am God welcoming into every area, every system, in Jesus' name. Miracle working power, Jehovah Nisi, the miracle worker, my victory banner. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And now, here's what I want you to do that charismatic Christians are not used to doing. Now I want you to open your eyes and keep your heart open and stay open to healing the rest of the day. It's not something you try to do. Trust means I'm just keeping the door open. And if you start living like that, you're going to see better health and better healing on a far greater level than what you've seen in times past. Because we've shut down. We have a tendency. Hope deferred makes the heart sick. And God created you with a self-healing body. He gave you an immune system that protects you from internal threats. When you like yourself, when you love what God has made and don't badmouth yourself, your immune system works better. He gave you an HPA factor, right? Hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal. I've heard Jennifer's teachings. I learned that. And that HPA factor is adrenaline, and it protects you from external threats. The problem is, I want to see the priesthood of the believer rise up to where you only use adrenaline when it's necessary. You don't walk running from lions all day long on your job. That is not healthy. That will destroy your physical body. Anybody that lives on adrenaline all day long, or fear, or anxiousness, or hyperactivity, is not under the lordship of Jesus. His lordship is evidenced by peace that rules, all right? So anyway, here's the seven areas again. Your spirit, let's pray that right now. I'm a new creation, something that never existed before. I'm a born-again believer, fused together in Jesus, cleansed by the blood. I am what I am by the grace of God, and I like me. I like the new creation me. That's not proud, that's not arrogant, to like what God has made. I like what God has made. He has done the work in me, and I'm a one of a kind. There never was another me. There never will be another me. And my spirit belongs to him. Awaken, awake, O sleeper. Any slumbering spirits, we just command in the name of Jesus to rise up and wake and be quickened in the name of Jesus. Increase your sensitivity. Cast off the insensitivity of heart. That's the way I welcome the lordship into that throne. The mind. I welcome the Jesus to be Lord of my thoughts. I don't basically get excited about my thoughts, but I want his thoughts. To honor him as a person, I want his thoughts, not my thoughts. His thoughts are higher than my thoughts. I want some higher thoughts right now. Something superior. I don't care if you're a genius. I want some thoughts that are higher than your thoughts. You're not that smart. God is. I want his thoughts that are supreme. I want his will, not my will. You know how to yield a will? You're doing it right now because there's a change in the atmosphere. Yield your will is like what you would call soaking. Down here, you release and you open the door of your heart to the Jesus in you. I yield my will, not my will. My delight is to do the will of God. When the will of God on the inside becomes a throne and his lordship rules, here's how you can tell if that will is being surrendered to him. First of all, the peace of God will ruling, but secondly, there will be a want to do the will of God, not a have to. Have to is religion. Have to is forced from the outside, but want to is on the inside. So I yield the throne of my will. Conquer that inner mountain. Conquer that inner throne. Welcome Jesus, the Messiah, on the inside to rule and reign in that throne. My emotions to belong to God. I was bought with the price. God, pull away the darkness and the screen that has been around the church where they do mind and will, But they've lost sight of the necessity that you are an emotional God, and that even the evaluation in the kingdom is emotional. Did you know that? For the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. Those were meant to be felt. Uh-huh. You've learned in the church, oh, you don't need those feelings. God gave you feelings for the fruit of the Spirit, and if you don't need those feelings, you don't need the fruit of the Spirit. That's ridiculous. All right? So, Father, right now, righteousness, by the way, is, under the new covenant, is love and action. So, actually, the kingdom of God is love, joy, peace. It's not your doctrine. It's Him. Him and your doctrine need to be the same. You need to know Him, not about Him, that I might know Him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of His personhood, all His attributes, all His character. Oh, that I might know Him, that I might drink Him, the life of God. I don't want to know about Him. I want Him. There's a disconnect in the body in that one statement. But knowledge needs to be knowledge of Him. You search the Scriptures, in them you think you have eternal life, yet they point to Me and you won't come to Me. We're fear of intimacy. We break that spirit of fear of intimacy in the days ahead, and we open our heart that I would delight to do Your will. Thy will in His pleasure. His will fused together with my will. It's like a romance of wills. Me and my Jesus, my will and Jesus' will are romantically intertwined, and it is my pleasure to do His will. I delight to do His will and to finish the work. That's bringing it under the throne of the will. The emotions is basically a feeling what God feels. I want what You feel, God, not what I feel. Any negative carnal emotion needs to be replaced with the fruit of the Spirit. I want the love, the joy, or the peace replacing my carnal emotions. I don't want anything come between what You and I have together. Next, I want to move to all relationships. This is the good, the bad, and the ugly. And particularly, I want even Rebecca to pay attention to this with all of my other pastors. Any judgments you've made against leaders in times past, you better get away with it right now, because you who judge, you will do the same thing. So, Father, right now, in the name of the Lord Jesus, any judgments that I've had against leaders or authority figures in my entire life, if a face flashes before my mind, I drop down to my spirit and I let the work of the cross have its way. I release loving forgiveness to it, break through it until it changes to peace. If it doesn't change to peace, I didn't have a supernatural transaction. There was no genuine work of the cross. I release forgiveness to every leader, every teacher, every mother, father, any authority figure in my entire life that comes to my mind, because you who judge, you will do the same thing. And so, Father, I let out of my belly flow a river of living water, anointed water that bursts through, and that wherever that living water flows, life is going to come out of the transformation and the anointing of God. Therefore, all relationships, the good, the bad, and the ugly, I release blessing. Bless them that curse you. Pray for them that despitefully use you and say all manner of evil about you. Out of my belly, I release loving rivers of water that forgives them. Unilaterally, they don't have to respond. All I have to do is say that they will no longer control me in any adverse way, because I'm releasing love to them. You can't be controlled when you're under the control of the Lordship of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Then I want you to go to possessions. This includes your gifts and callings, by the way, and this has been our ministry from the time I was a baby Christian. God always sent leaders to me who were highly gifted but had issues, that unless those issues were dealt with, they were limiting, greatly limiting the Holy One of God within them. So, Father, right now, all my possessions, including my gifts and my callings, I release them back to You. I am what I am by the grace of God, and I'm not Joe Heavy Speaker. I'm not some personality that needs to be adored. I am a humble servant of the Lord, and I release it. I have nothing good that I didn't get from You. So, Father, I release my gifts, my callings back to You. I release my house, my possessions, my property. I want you to get to the point that when you drive your cars, listen to me, people, when you drive the car, you feel like it's someone else's. I had that overwhelm me when God was teaching me this, and I'm telling you what, you don't understand what I'm talking about until you've had that kind of an experience. Seek that kind of an experience. It's not your house. They're not even your kids. How do you like that? They are God's children. You're a steward and a manager, not an owner. You own nothing. God owns you, and all of those possessions need to go to him. I think I'm saying more than you're grasping, but you can pray through by saying, help me, Holy Spirit, release afresh and anew all personal possessions, because I'm merely a steward here. I do not own the vineyard. It's your vineyard, and I have nothing that you did not give to me. No provision. So I release that. As a matter of fact, that prayer is probably not going to do you much good if you're not a tither, because you've already made an excuse why you don't have to. All right? And that would have to be dealt with first, because a tithe is simply a heart attitude. I release my possessions back to you. Especially if that's been a difficult area, lordship is not lordship in that area. So we release that in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hit some buttons on that tithing. I could feel even in this room, so let alone up by Ustream how many. But let's face it, in the days ahead, you want the security that God has. You can store up all you want, but I'll tell you what, real security is going to be that he's Lord of your life. If he's not Lord of your life, none of that's going to avail anything. It's going to be like having pockets with holes in it. Because fear does not fortify. Jesus fortifies. Seventh throne, your physical body. And thus saith the Lord, I am moving in the midst of my people in this dimension currently. This is a now word, that my physical body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And I'm believing that there's going to be a generation that's not just going to get healing, they're going to walk in divine health. I don't care what your father and your grandfather had, you don't have to have that. God is even now miraculously Jehovah Nisi, the miracle worker. He'll change your DNA. He'll make you flow with the blood of Jesus instead of the blood that's come down your family line. You don't have to take that stuff just because you've seen it. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I welcome myself afresh and anew. In the name of the Lord, I am the epitome. My anointing in this life is the opposite of my family line. So that should be your inheritance too. That basically whatever the weaknesses were should be your strongest anointings that you release to your children, your children's children from generation on. My spiritual children are going to walk in Holy Ghost acceptance, even though I could watch my grandfather and my father walked in rejection. They walked in rejection to such a degree that there was a time when I was a young pastor, I asked for men who had never heard a positive word about themselves come forward. And I opened my eyes and my own father was standing in front of me. Never heard an affirming word through a male voice. There's people that have lived like that, men and women. And I'm telling you, this is the day where that ends. This is the day where the supernatural power of God says, you're my beloved child in whom I am well pleased. I want you to hear that as the voice of the Father speaking to you, not as my voice, but through a male voice. This is, you are my beloved daughter. You are my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. May the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit alone write that on the tablet of your heart, then no one can erase that. I don't care what your experience has been like, you release forgiveness. Otherwise, you who judge, you'll do the same thing. So Father, right now, release mothers and fathers, release lack of mothers and fathers, release stepfathers, release pastors and leaders right now, because God is raising up a generation who are going to be sons unto the Father. And you cannot be truly fathers unto sons until you've been a son unto the Father. And God's raising up mature mothers and fathers in Christ who are going to be a blessing to the body of Christ, and they're going to take care, and they're going to raise them up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord, that what has been robbed out of your life is going to be restored in Christ Jesus. So Father, you're the God of restoration, and you're basically restoring all things. Cause us to be fully equipped to be as mature mothers and fathers to release a father's blessing upon your children. Bless them this day that you are accepted in the beloved, that you are not only accepted, you're wanted. You are desirable. Your acceptance is being written on the tablet of a heart, and you are one of a kind, unique, and there never was another you, there never will be another you. You are special in the sight of God, a unique specimen of his creation. You are not a product of your mother and father. If you are a product of your mother and father, you better start forgiving your mother and father, because you're supposed to be a product of the lordship of Jesus Christ as a new creation. If you see God the way you see your father, you've got some issues. If you see your mother the way you see God, you've got some issues. God's not like your mother or father. He's perfect, and he's loving. And you will not see that with clarity till you forgive them. Honor your mother and father so that things go well with you. To the degree you do not honor them, things won't go well with you. By honoring, I don't mean honor their bad behavior. I mean respond the way God would want you to respond, by forgiving them and releasing them, and then therefore making it an anointing that you won't do the same thing, because you who judge, you will do the same thing. How many people have heard that? Married couples. You're just like your mother. You're just like your father. You're just like my mother. If you're saying that, guess what? You need healing on mom and dad. It's not your husband or wife. You have unresolved conflict. God's not like them. If you bring his lordship to those seven thrones, I want you to understand that what God is basically saying today is, I'm releasing Kratos authority within each and every one of you has the capacity to do this. If you want to understand what that means, there's like three words that are used for authority in the Bible. There's exousia. Exousia is kind of like, if we pictured a policeman, it would be his badge. I have a badge. I have exousia, authority. Dunamis is authority when the cop kicks in the front door. All right, that's the power. Here's the authority to do it, and here's the power to do it. But there's the one that I believe God is bringing the church into, the last one. After he kicks in the door and he comes in, he sits down in your favorite chair and takes the remote and sits there and has dominion. And I'm going to watch on that TV what I want to watch, and I'm going to sit in your favorite chair because I've occupied now. That's Kratos. Isn't that a better picture than all those Greek words? I think sometimes we get lost in the Greek words when in reality they're Greek to me. All right, but in reality, you can picture that. I believe that what God wants for every believer is that we're entering into the day of the saints, or the priesthood of the believer, to where you operate in Kratos authority regardless of the jurisdiction, regardless of where you're at, in the home, in the work, in the church. Kratos, I like that. Because whoever has no rule over his spirit, this is where God started this process with me, Proverbs 25:28. Whoever has no rule over his spirit is like a city that's broken down without walls. That means the enemy can come in anytime he wants. All the doors and windows are open, and you're just, oh, I'm a victim. I don't know, why is everybody picking on me? It's because the rule of God is not being enacted in your life. So you can play the blame game forever and whine and complain. But if you're getting beat up left and right, and it's a regular basis, and you're saying the devil's beating me up, I have one question for you. How come when I talk to authorities, they're not getting beat up like you are? Are you more important than them? Are you so anointed that you get beat up all the time? Or is it your carnality, your windows and your doors are wide open all the time, and they just go, hey, that's easy, that person's easy. They got a sign, kick me. I don't hear leaders complain of spiritual attack like I hear believers complain of spiritual attack. That tells me you're beating yourself up with your unresolved areas in your life that really need death, burial, and resurrection, don't they? Huh? How come the leaders are not getting beat up? Smite the shepherd and the sheep will fall. That's his favorite tactic, is to smite the leader. And if the leader's not complaining, what's your issue? If you're wallowing around in your complaints, then it's time for you to grow up. And some are just waiting to go up. I got news for you. You're going to grow up before you go up. You're not going to escape. The second verse of Scripture is Proverbs 16:32. He who is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city. So we're not looking at these major accomplishments, but we're looking at how to bring the rule of the conquering king. Are you ready for a peace challenge? I want to do this on the 4th of July. The 4th of July is Jennifer's other birthday today. It's not really her birthday. Her birthday's January 4th, but we celebrate January 4th and July 4th because then I tell her all those fireworks I arranged for her. People used to overlook. Anybody have a birthday that used to get overlooked, like it's around Christmas or New Year's? Or Well, what we solved that with Jennifer. She used to get hers overlooked, so 4th of July, we give her a half birthday. And all those fireworks are to honor her. But today is a declaration of freedom. And it should be a day of birthing something good in you as well. And I want to challenge you this, that from this day forward, God is bringing healing gifts to this body. He's bringing good things, but he's also going to challenge your character like never before. And here's the challenge. First of all, Colossians 3:15, let the peace of God rule. I want you to write down in the days ahead to how often of a given day did peace rule. Put yourself to the test. Don't play church with your Bible knowledge. I'm not impressed. I'm impressed with the person that can walk in peace because that's the rule of God. That's lordship. Secondly, let the peace of God guide. In the Amplified, it says, let the peace, the soul harmony which comes from Christ's rule, act as an umpire continually. I want you to mark down every decision you make from the place of peace. Because every decision that a believer makes from fear, anger, guilt, or shame is not God. Might be good, but it's not God. Good's not God, but God is good. How many decisions do you make out of guilt, shame, anger, or fear? That's not God. Even if it was a good decision, it's still not God. Do you want Jesus to rule or not? You want to play games? You want to play church? See how I scare him up? You're visiting. You like to hear this every week. You go, oh my goodness. But we've got to bury that because you've got potential that you haven't tapped into. Peace guards. I'm going to let the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard my heart. And I will keep you in shalom, shalom, or perfect peace. My granddaughter has a prophetic word, and she's allowed to say whatever she wants at any given time. That doesn't go for the rest of you. Right? Peace is guarding your heart and your mind. She agrees. She nodded. That's all I need is one amen. I don't care about the rest of you. I have one in agreement. If one can chase 1,000, two 10,000. So my granddaughter and I will accomplish great feats. The God of peace is going to crush the enemy beneath your feet. Peace are the shoes that gather people. It's evangelistic, isn't it? How beautiful are the feet of them that preach good news? Those are shoes of peace. If you can't walk in peace, nobody wants what you've got. But it also brings them to what Jennifer and I believe, that when God told us to come here, and I saw the size of this building, I said, we're not going to be very big. And he says, this is going to be the base of operations for three separate ministries, most of which is done outside of this building. The vast majority is full stature. And it's basically around the world, and that keeps us busier than this building. But when I saw the size of this building, he says, because I'm going to raise up chiefs and quality people that will be able to replicate and duplicate with purity from this place. And yeah, the seeker-friendly type thing probably doesn't work real well here. Sometimes we're not even friendly, let alone seeker. I want someone who's passionate about God, who's willing to pay a price, who will be die to their agendas and die to their flesh and say, I want to be all that God created me to be and I want to delight to do his will, no baby food. I never wanted a crowd. I still do not want a crowd. I will try to diminish a crowd if their heart isn't for the lordship of Jesus. I'm not interested. I will give you the tools to teach you to stand on your own two feet, and we don't do counseling here. What we do is give homework here. If you don't do the homework, I'm not interested in helping you. I'm not an enabler. I'm an equipper. Amen. And that's going to change in the church in the days ahead. Once had a man who, to get his doctorate, snuck into my first pastorate, and he studied 70 pastors in a region. Now, many of them had 3 and 4 pastors per church, so that's still quite a few churches. And he wrote his doctoral thesis on enabling, a term that comes from the drug culture, enabling, giving someone that's an alcoholic, giving them something to drink, that's enabling, you're not helping, all right? The church has done that almost. And he says his doctoral thesis was on equipping and on enabling. And he says, out of the 70 pastors, I found 2. And later, I didn't know who he was. He came to my church. He said, by the way, you were the one. And my spiritual father, whose church was about 1,200 people, he said, he was number 2. He said, you're actually doing it more proficiently than he was. So I made sure I told him that because I'm humble. But still, what an honor. 2 out of 70 that were actually equipping. The rest, even though they were good churches, quality churches, they were still back into the babying and pampering Christians because they were trying to deal with the whole crowd. You know, it's kind of hard when you have all different levels of Christianity, how to get them all on the bus at the same time. It's kind of like, okay, there's some that are already on the bus, want to drive. And then there's others going, I don't know, this might be cold, it might be hot, it might be none of the above. How far are we going to go? Where are we going to get off? Are we going to have any food? You know, okay. So it takes a while to get everybody growing. But in reality, I believe what God's called us to do is to be an upper room. Remember he told us, Jennifer, you don't have a church. You're birthing a church. Because it's going to be a supernatural union and communion, not a crowd. So, Father, you began that good work. You're continuing that good work. And I believe that God is even now giving us the opportunity to perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle us in the strength that God has for us. So I want you to realize that those shoes of peace may gather people in, but it's the bonds of peace that we're working toward right now. You know what that means? Supernatural connections, supernatural relationships, that if something is truly evangelistic, it's going to attract people with the same DNA who are willing to pay the price. They're going to be bonded and connected and not even be able to explain it, but there's going to be greater and lesser knittings of the Spirit, not man putting something together, but a supernatural knitting, a tapestry that's made by the Spirit of the living God. And God basically says, and then, on that sure foundation of his lordship, I'm going to establish you in the kingdom, righteousness, love and action, peace and joy. And I've told you this so that you'll be unshakable and assured and deeply at peace. Because in this godless world, you're going to continue to experience difficulties. But take heart, I've conquered this world. And I've removed or deprived its ability to harm you. And God's basically saying to Kingdom Life Church, Full Stature Ministries, and Team Embassy, I am calling you this day to a new level of practice. And practice makes permanent. I'm calling you to exercise everything you know, because the value is going to come by reason of use. If you don't exercise it and you don't use it, you will lose it. We've had many people in our modules, in our churches over the years, they learned a certain amount but never practice it. They end up losing it and become spiritually dull to it, to where they'll just hear it in their head and go, oh, I know that. But until you are helping someone else, you don't have it. Until you can reproduce it in someone else's life, you're not doing anything. And if God's done something in your life and you don't do it with someone else, it's like burying your talent and burying your gift. So, Father, we just pray right now for the miracle-working power. And here's a word that I'm going to close with this. What God is speaking as far as dominion authority, we're going to see health rising up in a group of people. Not healing alone, health. Better health than you've had in previous years. So yes, he's there to heal sickness and disease, but you're going to start seeing better health in general. Look for it. Watch for it. Regardless of your chronological age, look for it. Begin to believe that Jesus, the Messiah, rising up with healing in his wings, is going to every part of your physical body. In Jesus' name. Jesus, the healer and the miracle working, is rising up in me this very day in dominion authority. And guess what? In my heart and in your heart, Jesus wants the throne. He wants to sit on the throne of your life. He wants the remote. He wants to rule. He wants to call the shots. He wants to tell you how to guide you into all truth. Let him rule the seven thrones, your spirit, mind, will, emotions, physical body, all possessions and all relationships, all seven mountains, all seven thrones under the lordship and the rule of Jesus. The days of Jesus being my Savior is not sufficient. The days now must arise where Jesus is my Lord. Many will prophesy, many will cast out devils, and he'll say, I know you not. That needs to be changed. We need to know him, that we need to progressively become more intimately acquainted. If you want to grow, stand to your feet. If you really want to know him more intimately, I know you've been in church for a long time, you know about him, but that I might know him. Now I'm going to release an anointing to awaken slumbering areas of your heart. Slumbering areas. We're going to awake the slumbering spirit this morning in the name of the Lord Jesus. Awake, awake, you sleeper, and arise. Let resurrection life rise up. Let new sensitivity, I release an impartation for new sensitivity to remove the barnacles and the hardness in the areas where religion has glossed over things till we've heard it so many times it has no effect. God says, I want you to go deeper into me. I want you to release yourself more fully and completely into the lordship of Jesus. I want you to come to me as a newborn babe with a new sensitivity. If I've grieved anyone, I prayed this and it really works. Try this one. If I offend in any way, shape, or form, God, I am welcoming a kick in the gut. I want my conscience to shout. I want barnacles removed and washed from any hardness in my heart. My conscience is a beautiful faculty that you placed within me for purposes of responsibility. Cleanse my conscience. Wash me on the inside by the washing of the water of the word and the renewing power of the Holy Spirit. I want my conscience to shout. I want a brand new sensitivity. With that brand new sensitivity to Jesus and his lordship will come a brand new sensitivity to sin. Cleanse me and cause that new sensitivity to rise in my heart. In Jesus' name, amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.